Hello, welcome to ET Global Town Hall. In this session today, I'm going to explore various aspects of the future of economy and emerging businesses. The situation is still very tricky around the globe. Few economies like India are trying its best and marching ahead to achieve new scales, but there could be obstacles around considering the geopolitical risks. But it's crucial to get a perspective on the potential future. And I have here with me an equity research stalwart and the most respectable name in the broking industry, Mr. Ramdev Agrawal, Chairman and Co-Founder, Motilal Oswal Financial Services. Mr. Agrawal, glad to have you here.
I'm very pleased to be with you and discuss some of the important things about the economy and the markets. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much, Mr. Agrawal. And I will begin with you a very basic question. So when I'm talking to you, I would like to understand, sir, how is the India Inc. shaping up? What kind of growth are you seeing in the market right now? And, you know, going ahead, what are the changes do you see? So, mota moti agar aapko main seedhe sawal puchu, to how do you see the Indian economy from now onwards?
Indian economy, you know, most likely it's a post-COVID, it's a completely different world. Actually, after some time we realize that COVID has changed completely rules of the game. My sense is there is a lot of awakening among the policymakers also, how to run the economy what will happen to the jobs, what will happen to the inflation, what will happen to the interest rates. I think everything is going to go for a reset. In case of India, we'll also have bumper Forex, in the sense that our foreign exchange reserve is upwards of $640, $650 billion post-COVID. So I think we are going to start with a new energy. We have a fiscal space which has been very widely kind of created for the post-COVID recovery. From 3.5%, we are talking about now 6.5% kind of a fiscal deficit. So there is a lot of space created for government to spend and infrastructure build up and things like that. So the recovery phase, which is starting now, will be very interesting. And when we are saying very interesting, so it is sector by sector. You see that there will be a lot of opening up trade. There will be a lot of change in the banking system. There's a lot of change in the work culture world over, and hence it is a flattening of the world at one level, because digital divide, in any case, digital economy was in any case flat, but now work from anywhere is going to make it even flatter. So right. What happens post COVID in the world economy, and hence in India also, it is an integral part of it. So I think there are a lot of positives, and clearly there are negatives, like a global breakdown of the logistics, the rise in, we never heard that there could be power cut in Europe and China. So those kind of, a lot of things are breaking down one by one. How much time it will take for it to come back and become normal, that also will be challenged. So shorter term looks a lot more challenge. And then longer term, of course, all these things we talked about, the good things will also play out.
Okay, very well said. It was a good beginning. So I will obviously speak to you specifically about the global dynamics and how it's impacted on the Indian economy. But since you mentioned about the recovery, let me take your perspective there specifically. My question to you, sir, is it a pent-up demand? We have seen a great rally, not only in Sensex, but specifically bank stocks. Like, nobody could have expected that SBI will rise more than 100 rupees within like 3 months of time, right? If you look at the stock market or specifically the share prices. And that's the same rally we can see in multiple stocks, specifically in banking and many other sectors. But the question, sir, is, the kind of recovery that we are seeing, is it a pent-up demand? Is it a recovery because of certain infusion that the government has done? Is it the recovery because of the RBI still not, what you can say, normalizing its stance and going ahead with what the package which has given to the economy?
So I think it's a combination of all. Everything is heading on to the push in the market. Markets are right now a lot more driven by the liquidity, cost of liquidity, collapse of fixed income. So all the roads lead to the equity markets. I think worldwide, it is one of the biggest influx of equity subscription worldwide. I think it's a record in last 7-8 months. And so is in India. And I think somehow the retail influx which is happening in India is unprecedented. Almost 3 to 4 million customers every month. So that's another thing which is changing. So that's one side of a stock market movement. But other side, in terms of pent up demand, yes, there are some sectors which are definitely driven by the pent up demand. But the global supply chain disruptions have led to many industries doing well, and some industries are definitely going to suffer because they will not be able to export, and the companies which are import protected, they will do very well because the imports will not be able to come efficiently. So I think and the markets are driven by the retail influx and cost of money and massive liquidity. So right. There is a lot of combination of factors which are working to propel the market up. Some of them are opening up trade, some of the pent-up demand, some of them are liquid driven, some of them are cost of money, some of them are about fixed income collapsing. So right now it looks there is only one game in town, that's the stock market.
Okay, noted your point, sir. But considering, the market is obviously driven by retail, but obviously the huge chunk is always foreign investors and the FII. They are very bullish, specifically on the Indian market. Considering we are in a recovery mode, considering we are, marching ahead towards a great world, how do you see the geopolitical risks? How do you see the global challenges? You partly mentioned that, but considering the coal shortage, considering the power outages, which is, kind of happening in small towns right now, and we are worried about so many other things as well. So do you see some global challenges now that may become obstacles in terms of the recovery going ahead?
Yeah, sure. I mean, one of the things is that inflation, global inflation is raging absolutely 5 to 6%, whereas the 10-year paper is trading at sub 1.5-2%. In Europe and Japan, it is lower, even lower. So clearly, there is no recognition of the fact that the inflation is absolutely there, and everybody is hoping that it will just disappear in 12 months' time or something like that. That's the feeling right now. So if that doesn't happen, because things are worsening by the day. If by chance that seems to be more persisting, then the hands of central bankers will be tight, and the hands they use their all the power to print money and they will flush the whole world market with the money might see very counted days. So if by chance the inflation persists and the bankers they decide that enough is enough, let's start tightening, and that would be kind of big global shock to the entire equity markets. Because if anything disrupts US markets, I don't think other markets will remain unaffected. So that's and because of communication and digital economy, the entire world is interconnected. So you could underperform or outperform somebody by a few percentage, but directionally, I think everything is interlinked. So my sense is if there's a global disruption in the inflation or interest rates, inflation persists, and finally they take the call that interest rates have to be raised to control the inflation, then I think we'll have a slightly different discussion than the way we are looking at things right now.
No, obviously, sir. Let me ask you let me cross question you here, and if you could tell me, I know it's a hypothetical situation, but what is your sense? What are the chances of, US increasing the rate? What are the chances of, those impact will be there transferred to India as well? What are the chances of that story?
Nobody can put the date on the whole thing because it is not decided, and I'm the least of it. I have very little understanding of these forces, but it's not forever. I mean, if not 6 months, 1 year. So it is dated. I mean, now how long that date is, how far that date is? Is it 6 months away, 3 months away? And longer it takes, more abrupt it will be, because the same loose monetary policy is leading to a lot of disruption in demand and things like that. So so I think till effective measures are taken, I think the current problems will not be sorted, and hence the problems will become deeper, and it will force the bankers to act. And I think it will be sooner than very far off in time.
I have always heard the economists or top brokers or the financial analysts or specifically, the people talking about FMCG sector, retail sector or auto sector, these are kind of a charming sectors when it comes to the investment. But in last 1 or 2 years, the rally has changed. New online companies have also come and everything. So going ahead, you know, how do you see the whole economy shaping up? Because the new businesses emerged during the pandemic. There are a lot of investments happening specifically in the new businesses. And the old businesses, obviously, it's not that they're outdated. They're still doing better. But, you know, there is a rally in the new sectors as well. So how do you see the economy shaping up in new businesses?
Yeah, so it is very interesting time. I mean, US and China, they've already done. Top 10 US companies are today, I think 8 or 9 are technology companies. And that too of the size of $2.5 trillion. So clearly, we won't be very far. And now we are getting our version of digital companies getting listed now. And whole battery of them are lined up in next 6 months to 1 year. So we will have in 2 to 3 years time, I think we'll have reasonably large number of companies. And my sense is in 5 years time, almost 20-25% of our market cap will come from these companies. So it is going to be significant. Good thing is that every company is different. In digital space, they're exploiting the one common internet infrastructure, but the businesses are very different. Every business is different. So it could be, you know, something coming from insurance, something coming from banking, something coming from, NBFC, something coming from delivery, and something from retail. So very consumer, a lot of consumer centricity will be there, but every business will have a very unique business model. And hence, since they are unique in themselves, they can be extremely large because there are not too many companies copying them. So they'll be unique and the whole space will be owned by 1 or 2 guys. So I think you'll see consolidation and rise in size very quickly because the capitalism in the internet space is far more friction-free compared to the old economy. And hence, the scaling up happens very fast. And market being efficient, what it does is that if this company can scale up in next 5 years, today only they start getting the valuation. And hence, earnings will come after 5 years, but the P multiple, the only way to appreciate that in the marketplace is by raising the price. And that automatically, you know, your P multiple looks very high. So that's how I think it is going to shape up. And this is what has happened in US. I don't know so much about China, but definitely in US. And this is going to happen in a big way in India because the digital companies, the number of digital companies in the large economy is going to be quite a few. And we are seeing some samples of that.
Okay. So you see a major consolidation, right? Because you see a major consolidation also. You don't get any view specifically on these companies will also overpower India Inc. Because it looks like that scene right now that many companies are valued far more than even the mid-sized companies, mid-sized banks, you know, the payment companies or fintech companies, right? So don't you see that they will overpower these existing companies by any chance?
Right now, there could be a lot of enthusiasm, but some of them will definitely overpower the existing companies in their respective field. But I think the old companies, see, first thing is that the world is more physical than digital, you know. And right now, a lot of large businesses would be physical right now, and they will definitely get converted into digital, and they'll give a very effective competition to even pure digital companies. So my sense is that we still don't have very pure digital companies. It's more physical in character. There are a lot of back-end thing which is done very physically, and in that case, I don't think that the companies, old companies, which are willing to change, they have that much disadvantage. They have a lot of resources, they have a lot of cash flow. And if they have the management who are willing to change with the time, I think they can give very effective competition to the new upcoming so-called digital companies.
Again, a bit hypothetical, sir, but going ahead, considering the rally. And why I'm asking you this question is because the whole new world is about the startups now. That's what they're saying. The new era is about the startups. So the rally that we see specifically in the stock market or, you know, in top companies from the foreign investors, will it shift the startup world going ahead by any chance? Do you see that the foreign investors, large investors, you know, will take huge interest in the digital rally or the digital tech companies going ahead?
In fact, the rally in startup world is far more than the secondary world right now.
Right.
So you see the birth of unicorns almost every day or every week, 2 or 3 of them are getting born or valued like that. So that is imparting momentum like never before. Every day, I believe in Bangalore, if you go half the cafe are nothing but pitch bookshop. So, you know, there's so much happening in the, I believe India's startup investment now has touched about 10 to 15% of the US startup investments on a yearly basis. So that's a very, very large number. So, and that's further scaling up, and it is running into tens of billions of dollars, maybe 40, 50 billion dollars. So that has the potential. See, what the very, you know, sustained, what do you call, warm market, even in the secondary market, does is that it provides massive amount of capital to the true enterprises. Because market has two roles to play. One, to provide liquidity, and second, to provide capital to the entrepreneurs. So when the entrepreneurs start getting valued for their successful enterprises in a elevated fashion, it gives kick to not only him, but the guys behind him. And that attracts a lot of capital into the new startups or mid-sized companies. And then that circle, that virtuous cycle, that you give, you raise the secondary market price, the capital goes to the primary market goes into the capex and build up, that creates jobs and a lot of capex. And that again comes back to, because those capex, they again become income of the old companies. They increase their earnings and again, they get the PE multiple. So that particular circle is happening right now. I hope this circle continues, not for 6 months, but a few years. And then you'll see the real economic boom in India.
Okay. Very well said, sir. In fact, a detailed, you know, you highlighted this part, you know, far more in far more meaningful manner. So again, one question is specifically about India, Inc., because, you know, when you speak about the future of the economy or how economy will shape up, we always look at the blue chip companies, right? At one side, you know, we had a major issue that the financial institutions didn't have a liquidity earlier, but now that is not the case. But now, in fact, the situation is that the corporates or even mid-sized corporates are not, you know, coming with a huge demand, and bankers, financial institutions are looking for a demand, and they are, you know, they are worried that the corporate demand is not huge. Until and unless this corporates doesn't go to banks, until and unless banks don't fund or, you know, don't, what you can say, suffice with this credit demand, the economy will still not recover to a level which we expected or which we expect. What is your view here? You know, what is stopping corporates, you know, from investing into large projects? According to you, must be talking to a lot of, you know, top players, mid-sized players. That is point number one. And point number two, is there still kind of a reluctance due to whatever we are facing in the pandemic world?
No, I think my sense is that it is a lack of demand in the economy.
Okay.
See, government can invest without profit motive, but private sector will always do investment looking at the profit motive or the outlook in the future. Okay. And that can come only if there is effective demand in the economy. So the recovery being K-shaped, what has happened is all the rich people have become richer.
Yes.
And say one third of the population is better off, and two thirds of the population is worse off. And the savings are with the one third of the population. That's where the corporates belong. But two thirds are the consuming population, which don't have job, which don't have purchasing power. So I see nothing happening for them. So long as the demand at the bottom of the pyramid or the bulk of the population, I would say two thirds of the population, they don't get, I mean, nobody's bothered about their demand pattern, their demand scene, you know, their jobs. So if that is not taken care of, government can keep pumping in terms of their infrastructure spend. Yes, that is going to do finally a lot of good to the economy, demand for steel, cement, workers. But since our infra spend is just about 8-10% of GDP, and the destruction of, because of COVID, destruction of jobs are far, far widespread. I think there is some demand management has to be done. Demand, because we have done only monetary stimulus. We have not done fiscal stimulus for the, you know, masses. Okay. So I think there is some, my sense is there is a frustration, there is a lot of disappointment at the demand level of the masses. And unless that is built, I don't think private sector is going to build up capacities just in the air. What will you do with the capacity?
Right.
If there is no demand, there is no, there is no point in putting up additional capacity and creating headache for yourself.
Partly mentioned the government, but we cannot, you know, go ahead without talking the government. So the government issue here is the government has been kind of very active. You know, they pumped in a lot of capital. They came with a lot of schemes, even ECLG scheme for the MSMEs. And now they're talking aggressively about the disinvestment plans, you know, whether LIC or Air India, what they did with, you know. My question to you in two parts. One, what else government should do maybe to boost the demands, to shape up the future of the economy, to support the emerging businesses? That is point number one. And second is, what kind of impact have you seen of the, all the decisions that the government has done taken right now, till now?
You know, government has been very proactive. They have been doing a lot of things. Mm-hmm. So wonderful things. So there's no complaint for what government is doing. But I think the demand buildup, I mean, I'm not a great, but there is, we can see the weakness of demand around oneself, the mass demand which is there. And I think to some extent, even the post-COVID opening up is also not happened, like marriages. And I think marriages are very large source of demand in India, maybe 5 to 10% of GDP every year. And that machine is completely out of action. So as the opening up happens in the next 6 to 8 months, I think that demand will also build up. So that is one aspect of it. Second is that I think we need some kind of a demand booster for the masses. Because if you cannot increase their income, you need to make things cheaper for them.
Right.
There's no other way. I mean, either you create jobs, the jobs will come only if there is demand. I mean, unless the new investment happens from the private sector, I don't think new jobs will be created. Till you are not created the jobs, how do you increase the demand? Because unless you increase the demand, jobs cannot be, the factories cannot be put up. So it's a chicken and egg story. I think one time push has to be given to demand post-COVID. And once that thing starts working, then you can withdraw your stimulus or whatever. That's a simple thinking at my end. But I'm sure their managers are thinking about it.
Noted your points, sir. And let me ask you a last question. Let me wrap up here with your last comment specifically on what we discussed is obviously the startups, emerging businesses and traditional businesses going ahead, maybe in next 6 to 12 months. I think now making an analysis of 6 to 12 months is not that difficult, which was earlier. The data is there. The third wave is also not going to be far more aggressive. That's what we learned from the health analysts and experts, and let's hope for the same. In next 6 to 12 months, what according to will play a major role for the economy like India? What will, you know, put India again in a scale up India going ahead? And also if you could add, what are the sectors, what are the industries that you are very bullish on? Because, you know, in last 12 to 18 months, they faced a lot of challenges, but now as with 60,000, you know, Sensex, they are also, you know, shaping up really well. So what are the companies, sectors specifically, not companies, you think will, you know, reach to a next level?
Let's go one by one. What was the first part you said?
First was specifically about, you know, which are the sectors that you think will, you know, reach to a next level. That is one. Second is about, you know, how it will benefit India.
Yeah. So, you know, sector wise, you know, there are external looking sectors like tech, digital economy, you know, that's driving the world mad. And we are the enablers of digital economy. So I think we'll be right at the center there. The current year, last year export was 150 billion. We could be doing 175, 180, or maybe even more. So I think that's one area where there will be growth and there will be a lot of action out there, even a lot of job creation out there. So that's tech will be one center of action for the many years to come. So and in every respect, it is going to be helpful. So that's tech and digital economy will be one. Second is that banks have gone through a painful period, a very painful period, and largely they've been cleansed up of their own bad books and things like that. Government has also initiated formation of bad bank. So economy is waiting to take off in the sense that we want to go from 3 trillion to 6 trillion. The 3 trillion has about $2 trillion of credit, almost 140, 150, or sorry, about 110, 115 lakh crores of credit. But the next 3 trillion will require more like almost 200 lakh crores of credit. So the credit opportunity will be very large in the next 5-6 years. And credit, I hope credit cycle is turning for good. So I think one side, the demand for credit will be strong. And on the other side, the credit cost will be very low because we are coming from a heightened credit cost. So I think banking will be, particularly private sector banks who are geared up to encash on this growing opportunity of lending and strengthening balance sheet. I think that will be the that'll be another big sector where things will happen. And then of course the insurance is also there, which has been passed on from public sector to private sector. That will also be a huge beneficiary. the business design is much better. The penetration is very low, and growth opportunities for the insurance companies is going to be good. There are new entrants to the Sensex and Nifty. I think that they are going to show their color in the years to come. So these are three, four very large sectors apart from micro sectors like if the infra and real estate picks up by chance, then your steel cement demand is going to pick up. But I think real estate is also coming out of a 10, 12 years of down cycle. So that has a, there's no replacement to buying house or offices. So that has a potential. I think the only thing which holds me back, maybe my understanding is weak, is the demand. The demand from the masses. That seems to be a little lacking, but still we are not fully open up. Still we are in the early stage of, there's still fear of third wave is there. So I think as in next 6 months, as the world gets vaccinated fully, my sense is that all these sectors will gain strength every quarter.
Noted. And sir, partly, how do you see India, shaping up really well compared to many other countries in the world because of our benefits of these sectors, the young population and everything?
Yeah, see, India has very unique opportunity right now. This is one third large country after US and China that India is, the world needs, world also wants to go from 85, 90 trillion to say 150 trillion in the next 10, 15 years. And one country, every time one country takes the center stage, last time it was China. This time, my sense is that if we play our ball well, I think India has the chance to be the center of attraction for the world. And in any case, the next theme of development for the world is digital, and India is right at the center of it in terms of enabling it and in terms of really powering it ahead. So I think India has a terrific chance. And we have a very stable government, and they are as ambitious as the private sector. So my sense is the combination of stable government and their foresightedness in terms of trying to make it happen. I hope nothing happens which will stop the entrepreneurs from building this country, because the biggest asset of this country is the entrepreneurs. And if nothing stops them. I think getting one single point agenda in economic growth, that is 8% GDP growth for next 5, 6, 7 years, I think that will do magic. That will solve a lot of problems. Not all the problems, but most of the problems of India, whether it is per capita income, whether it is jobs, whether it is, a lot of things can be sorted with the 8%, because the kind of tax you can collect, the tax buoyancy, that will sort out your defense problem, your fiscal deficit problem, your currency problem, your, I don't know. When I think of it, looks to be 8% consistent GDP should be the only single point economic agenda for this country, which is very likely to happen. That would be my wish, and that I think should be happening.
Great, sir. I'm sure that will happen. Let's hope that should happen. Thank you so much for sharing your perspective here and highlighting, many various aspects of the Indian economy and, giving a sense on the future of economy as well, and how the emerging businesses will be there. Thank you so much, sir, once again for taking part into Economic Times Global Town Hall and sharing your valuable thoughts and insights. Thank you so much.
Thanks.